Hi, welcome back to the KVEC offices at the Holler Studio. I'm Johnny Belcher here with Katrina Sloan, and we have Chris Bentley and Teresa Emmerich here as a second part to our first overview that we just gave about the TCT process as well as the Kentucky assessment system. What we're trying to hone in on just quickly to, in the second part is some frequently asked questions, things that we're hearing from teachers in the field, administrators in the field, as well as what Chris and Teresa have given us feedback from their travels. And so we're going to start with just some quick questions to ask that maybe you have. And I think Katrina will start us off.
Okay, so one question we've had is, how long should I spend on a single through course task?
Well, that's a good question. There is not a set time on this. Now, what we have been telling teachers, a class period, a couple of class periods to scaffold some instruction around these is not unheard of. What we don't want is this to become a driving instructional piece in your classroom and teach a unit on TCT. That's not what these are. These are snapshots. They're designed to be given in a class period or a couple of class periods. Some of them I can see where you might want to take a couple of extra days to build with some instruction, but pretty much it's a class period or two, a couple of days.
Gotcha.
Okay. So do I have to create a TCT myself?
No. We get that a lot. That's a misconception out there. We worked with teachers this fall and coached them through doing this. There were several of us at KDE that did that. And so they created these. These will be shared on the SharePoint. And for right now, you know, the task template is on the home page of SharePoint on the TCT page. If they wanted to try to do something for Classroom Embedded, but they would never have to create one for this.
I think that might be what caused that question, that people saw that and thought, oh,
There was some information that went out early that teachers might want to build these this year, but in order to calibrate like we're expecting, they need to have the same task. Mm-hmm. So we're asking mm-hmm. the teachers to deal with SharePoint and use the tasks that are associated with their grade.
And Chris, when you say calibrate, is that just more or less us learning how this goes together and kind of our instruction becoming such that it supports this?
We know what you mean? The definition of calibration is to reach the same standard. Everybody understands what good is. And so if we use different tasks to do that, then you really wouldn't have the same understanding.
Gotcha.
So if you're using a task you created and you're using the one that you created, then calibration may not be good because the quality of the task may not be the same. Even though you might use the same practices and cross-cutting concepts, the quality of the task might be somewhat different. And so calibration becomes very difficult to do if you don't use the same thing.
And Johnny, like before we ever created this TCT process or the TCTs, while we were still in networks, I would have teachers say to me, how do I know that what I'm teaching or my instruction is the same as the district next to me
or
the
school? Or good enough.
Yeah, or good enough. You know, how do I know that my students are getting the same level of instruction? So I think this answers that question and helps us to get on the same page with what seventh grade, you know, instruction looks like for the new science standards.
Understood.
I don't think we can say new anymore.
Yeah, they've been around for a while. So you answered this question in the first video, but I want to revisit because I think it's an important question. If I do TCTs, will it cover all my standards if that's all I do?
I'll take it again. No, it's not. Your standards are to be met by your students, and to meet those performance expectations, those standards, it's an end game. So good instruction is needed utilizing as many practices and as many sense-making lenses, cross-cutting concepts as you can around a piece of content to get students to reach proficiency around that standard. So TCTs are designed as a snapshot of student performance within those practices specific to the task and cross-cutting concepts. So there's just not enough there to meet the needs. And remember, TCTs are untethered from the PEs, mm-hmm. from the performance expectations. So the content may or may not be associated with the DCI and the grade band that you're teaching. So you're going to need a whole lot of good instruction to meet those PEs. So it's not enough.
No. And to add to that, in our science assessment system, there are three components. And TCT is one component, and it gives us a particular kind of evidence about the practices and cross-cutting concepts. So our classroom embedded assessments are going to give us another piece of evidence. Yeah. That day to day, minute by minute kind of stuff to see how students are doing and how I need to shift my instruction. And then there's the summative, which gives a whole different kind of evidence. Mm-hmm. So those three kinds of evidence work together to give us this whole holistic picture.
Gotcha. Okay. So what about students working together on the TCTs? Can they work in groups?
Well, I wouldn't suggest to anyone to work in groups or not. What I would suggest to teachers is, as long as you're not interfering with the intent of the task, and by that you need to become familiar with the task, the annotation, the student work that's in those tasks, all the resources that each task has with it, supporting resources in SharePoint, to truly understand the task. Now, to facilitate that task, what's best for your students? These are teacher decisions that happen in the classroom. Some teachers might want to use group work to engage with a specific, for example, analyzing data. I spoke of that in the video earlier. If part of the task was analyzing data, but the true intent of the task was to develop reasoned questions, you might want to facilitate or scaffold part of that analyzing data so students, all students in your classroom, can have equal opportunities to come to those same realizations about the data. If you had students that really struggle with it, perhaps maybe pairing them up wouldn't be a problem, or having larger group discussions wouldn't be a problem, as long as it's not interfering with the intent of the task. That is the key question, or the key point here I want to make. These tasks are specifically designed to yield evidence from student learning around a specific practice or portion of a practice, and a specific reasoning, sense-making lens in the cross-cutting concept. And if you interfere with that, you're only fooling yourself, because these are tools that teachers are using. And to say, oh, my students did wonderful at this, so there's no accountability, so why would you care? But you want to meet the needs of those students, meet them where they are, and move them forward.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha. Chris, one of the things that phrases we hear a lot and has been mentioned is intent of the task. Mm-hmm. What do you mean by intent of the task?
Well, like I was saying, if you go into the annotation and the resources within SharePoint, the teachers who developed these tasks were real clear about what they want to get from those tasks. What is this crucial pieces of information within the practices and cross-cutting concepts? So thinking about that, if you would go into Appendix F and G within the Kentucky Academic Standards, you would see those specific practices listed, and they're bulleted out very, very individually by grade band. So for example, analyzing data would have several bullets under analyzing data.
What that really looks like, breaks it down for teachers so that you know, what does that mean for my grade level?
So our teachers, when they developed them, that's where they went to really hone in on what specific part of the practice am I wanting to get evidence of.
And that's in the annotation guides.
That's right. But teachers, if I'm a teacher and I'm going to my PLC to plan with other teachers, those are the resources that would be most helpful for really understanding what the intent of that task is, honing in on the specific piece of the practice and specific piece of the cross-cutting concept. Or the cross-cutting concept that you want your students to engage with to create understanding and reasoning of this particular phenomenon that you're looking at.
So for that intent of the task, they can go to that table where it says success criteria. Mm-hmm. That's the intent of the task. What's in that table?
So as long as that's being met, or when that's reviewed, the task intent is still there. Mm-hmm. Based on that selection criteria or success criteria, then we've met the intent.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So that's the information that I want to get from the students.
Yes.
Do those things?
Mm-hmm. That's right. That's what students are leaving in their work that you're going to be looking at.
Mm-hmm. Well, that phrase, intent of the task, I've heard, and you may have already addressed this and I missed it, but intent of the task is used pretty often when the option of altering the task is out there. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we've been told that it's okay to alter as long as the intent of the task is maintained. Is there any advice there that you would give to teachers?
Yeah, I've told teachers when we're in these sessions across the state, I don't think I would ever lay just that packet on a student desk, even though I'm going to facilitate it and interact with kids. I think sometimes those 3, 4, 5 pages would just be a little overwhelming, whether it's a fourth grader, fifth grader, or an eighth grader. So, for example, I know that fourth grade task, I guess it's third and fourth, Bundles of Joy. There's maybe a picture on the front of that, And when those teachers started to develop that, that was an infographic of those different sizes of animals. And so when they gave that infographic to the fourth graders, they were confused. So they recreated that into that picture. Some teachers have said, I think this would be confusing as well, so could I recreate this picture so that that those little bitty pictures, I don't even know what they are, a rat and something else, right. You know, so that that would be a little plainer for them to see. Yes, by all means. There's a graph on there that some people haven't liked because it's going to produce a horizontal bar graph instead of a vertical bar graph. If that bothers you, you can change that because they're still analyzing the data within that. I've also told people, you know, if you want to retype that prompt on just one piece of paper, do that. That none of that is going to interfere with collecting the data I need on analyzing and interpreting data for patterns. Mm-hmm. I don't even think that's the intent of that one, but if it were,
it's argumentation.
Argumentation. None of that.
Plain evidence,
yeah,
and reasoning.
It's going to interfere with that.
Understood. Now, when we collect, this teachers collect student samples of work, and maybe they have made some slight alterations that don't change the intent. Should we be kind of collecting what those alterations were, or what should, I know the process is still developing as far as us turning in work samples or student samples, but do you have any thoughts about that?
Well, I think that's kind of up to those teachers in those PLC meetings on how they, what plan they put together to administer it. So if they come to some of these same realizations that Teresa just mentioned during planning for the task, they anticipate those problems that their students might have and say, well, you know, I'm planning on changing this graph to look like this. Those would be conversations that teacher teams would have. Those would be professional conversations, mm-hmm, about how those teachers are best using this task to get the information in it. Mm-hmm. So it's not something that KDE necessarily is interested in.
Yeah,
it would be great to have those conversations with those teachers and truly understand how they facilitated to get the work they got. So the question, as an administrator, for example, the question I would have when a student comes to a PLC meeting with their work, student work in hand, is to say, that's wonderful, how did you get it? What, mm-hmm, did you do that produced this work? And so those are those really important conversations that happen that will only happen when professionals get together to discuss planning and then in the post-task analysis. That would be, you know, if a teacher sat down across the desk to me and said, look how wonderful my students did, the question would be, great, how'd you do that? Show me what you did instructionally to get that produces this work.
I understand. So that's in the process of the post-task analysis,
yeah,
and making sense of what happened. So,
and you know, if you've got those feedback questions developed, mm, and you have a student who's really struggling, maybe making that graph, creating that graph, you have to give that student a lot of support with that. That's not going to affect whether they can, you know, do the argumentation piece. I'm going to take note of that so that I can take that into the post-task analysis and we can discuss it. How many kids did we really have to help with that? Because that's an issue. That's an instructional issue we've got to address some other time.
Now, analyzing data was the first part of the task, but the argumentation was the second part.
Mm-hmm.
And so you're getting valuable information during administration of the task about what your student's ability to evaluate data or to analyze data. So that would certainly be a formative piece that I would need to address in my daily instruction. I would my classroom embedded would certainly reflect the need of those students, mm-hmm, going forward until I felt like that they had met that understanding of analyzing data.
And Chris, you talked about, you know, if my colleague across from me has, you know, this great student work and everybody's done really well on that, is that really going to help us if I've over scaffolded or I've over simplified everything for students
and kind of taken, walk them through it?
Yeah, and taken all that grappling out where, mm-hmm, they really have to productively struggle, mm-hmm, through that. Yeah, it looks great for my administrator, or you know, I may want to one up my colleagues, but
that's
doesn't.
That's not the uses of the TCT.
That's not the use of the TCT, and that doesn't really help us. If any of you have ever done went through the national board process, you know, it's scary when they don't get it, that, you know, in your student work or the video, it's like, oh no, they didn't understand it. But when you write that up, it's a whole lot better analysis than if they'd done it perfect. So think of this as the same thing.
Yes.
That it's just really looking at those mistakes that the students made and analyzing.
Yeah,
excellent
growth.
Analogy. Switching gears just a little bit with the next question is, should teachers ever grade or score the TCT before submitting to district then to KDE?
So, no.
No.
This is a formative process, so you do not want to put a score on these at all. Again, feedback to the students is necessary, it's needed in order to move those students, but you should never grade anyone when you know that they're learning that skill. It'd be like grading me tonight when I go out to try to fly a plane for the first time. I certainly know what I'm going to score on that first go around with me flying a jet. So I do not need you to reinforce my opinion of myself that I do not have that skill with a 40% or whatever it might be. So no, we do not grade these. These are tools. Use them to know where your students are and what you as a teacher need to do. And the students need to use these as well with the feedback from the teacher to self-analyze where they are in relationship to meeting the understanding of the practices and cross-cutting concepts. So a grade is going to defeat the purpose here of what we are actually asking our teachers and students to do with these.
Understood. Now, I think we've answered this in the previous video, but maybe it's good to repeat, is one question was of teachers and other folks, sometimes this comes up, do I administer TCTs like a test? Because that's what we're used to doing when the department is involved with assessment.
I think that we've all watched that accommodations video or administration training or whatever it is. This is nothing like that. This should be just like a normal day of instruction where you facilitate. It's very difficult to pull instruction and assessment apart when we're talking about formative assessment. So no, it wouldn't be like you would administer the summative assessment.
And I've told the teachers that if it looks like a test, you're doing something wrong, okay?
Oh,
we really need to be involved with the facilitation aspect and planning for it. We've never planned for assessments before. Now we're planning for assessment like you would with a student instruction, or classroom instruction rather. So we really need to focus on that particular piece of it, because that's something the teachers are thinking. Mm-hmm. We're going to lay it on the desk and step back and pat students on the back and say, do your best. It's not so anymore.
So I can actually ask students questions as they're working. I can have conversations with students as they're working. Again, as long as I'm not interfering with the intent of the task. Mm-hmm. I'm not asking questions that basically guide them toward an answer.
I always like to ask a question. If a student asks me a question, I like to answer with another question at the end.
Guys, I'm crazy.
Yeah, it feeds them forward,
So something, I've heard teachers talk about is we're going to have to retrain our students, because students are also familiar with that aspect of assessments, looking at a piece of paper in front of them, and they may not want to engage with the teacher during facilitation to say, I'm having trouble with this.
Mm-hmm.
So it's something that they need to know going into it. It'd be a conversation I would have with my students. Hey, this is about instruction. I want to see what you guys can do here on this practice and cross-cutting concept. If you are having difficulty, raise your hand. And we'll try to come around to you with those pre-planned feedback questions that move those students from an impasse into somewhere that they can engage in those tasks.
Gotcha. Understood. Well, the last question we've got for you is a doozy, so I'm going to actually read it.
Okay.
I've been teaching for a while, and I feel comfortable with my content. But how do I incorporate science and engineering practices and cross-cutting concepts into my instruction?
I'll let you take that one.
Okay. So that's a typical question that teachers have, especially teachers like me that's been doing this for a long time. I'm a former high school physics teacher, and I'm content-based. Good teachers around the state have always incorporated practices and cross-cutting concepts. It's kind of an innate thing with good teachers. You can see it in their classrooms. You see their students really getting involved with it. As a resource for maybe young teachers or old teachers like me that's really not been engaging in those year to year, again, I would tell those teachers to go to the Appendix F and G with the practices and cross-cutting concepts. Use those bullets per grade band as resources to truly get an understanding of what those students need to be doing instructionally every day and how your tasks need to be created in your classrooms to get evidence of those specific practices and cross-cutting concepts. It's a shift in instruction for a lot of people. Asking questions would have been my biggest weakness as a teacher. Not by me, but by having my students ask those reasoned questions, those scientific questions, if you will. And so I would need a resource, and those appendices offer that as a resource. What does asking good questions look like? K2, 3, 5, 6, 8, and 9, 12. what those things need to do. And remember, those are written by end of grade band. So if I'm a K teacher and I read that, I'm just like, man, that's hard for those kids to do. Well, it's by the end of K, it's by the end of grade two that they have to master that practice, mm-hmm. That grade band. So those are wonderful resources for them, Johnny, to have that understanding of what to do, what my tasks need. Now, that's another thing. Even our teachers that built these tasks, looking at those, well, what does my task need to have in it that would allow students to produce this work, right? Mm-hmm. So that's a completely different conversation. How do I build those tasks? Right now, we're offering these tasks with TCT as a way for them to see some tasks that ask them to do that.
Mm-hmm. So the process itself that we're involved in is going to help us do that.
Certainly, yeah. Absolutely.
So we'll be looking at them as kind of examples of what a task might look like
within
instruction.
As one of the outcomes of TCT, we want to provide that to teachers across the state to say, okay, this is what this task does, and this is what I wish to get out of it.
Gotcha. I think that our video series, when we're capturing teachers during these next
follow-up videos.
Yeah, follow-up videos with these phases of the TCTs, I think that will answer that a little bit too. That'll show people maybe what that should look like. Mm-hmm.
So as we said in our first segment of just getting started, what our plan is to, through the month of February, collect video footage, also bring other folks into the picture, and hopefully build a video series that will help us to take next steps even more so after we've gone through this pilot process. And so we look forward to that. Now, we've covered a lot of ground in questions, but what if someone has additional questions beyond what we've asked today? Where do
email
we address
Chris
that?
Bentley.
Email Chris Bentley.
Well,
I'm just kidding.
We are fielding questions as we go around the, mm-hmm. the state right now, and some of these questions obviously are very difficult. And so we'll have some answers for them. If it's these questions here, we've handled these questions probably 20 or 30 times by now.
Right.
So going forward, there will be questions as far mm-hmm. as administration, some technical issues that we probably haven't thought through yet, some more directions coming from OAA at KDE, acronym here. So Office of Assessment and Accountability from the Department of Education will be sending information out to District Assessment Coordinators, the DACs. So I can throw another one in there. But yeah, these will be coming out, and there are going to be more questions, and there's more answers to come. So yeah, Teresa Emmert or Chris Bentley.
We'll put all that information up on the screen.
Yeah, and the other science consultants we'll put that, because there's a lot of us to answer those questions.
Absolutely. We can't thank you enough for being here today. We know how much or how busy you are right now, and the miles that you're covering just between the two of you for the entire state of Kentucky. Anyone that has traveled from east to west across Kentucky really has a feel for what you're trying to do.
A couple times now.
Yeah.
Absolutely. But we thank you for joining us, and on behalf of KVEC and the region, we thank you for your work with our students. Katrina, anything that you have left?
Can't think of anything else.
Okay, well, we thank you for being a part of the video. We hope it's helped you to understand the TCT process more completely. Thank you.